Welcome, we'll start with the third lesson for history class 10th. Here we would talk about the nationalism in India. In the last two chapters, we have focused about how nationalist movement started in Europe and then in Indochina. Now coming on to India, there was always a question of who are we, what is our sense of belongingness, what is our identity, and to answer all these questions, the idea of nationalism was promoted by few of the major leaders across India. Now, Mahatma Gandhi was one of the major leaders who took this campaign, and when he returned from South Africa in 1915, he talked about the idea of satyagraha. When he talked about satyagraha, his basic focus was a search for truth and understanding the power of truth along with dharma. So those were the key ideas that he talked about. Now pursuing that, there were three major things that happened. In 1916, it was the Champaran movement that was against the oppressive plantations that were prevalent in that region. In 1970, the protest was in Kheda in Gujarat after the crop failure and plague that was seen in that region. The people demanded relaxation on the collection of revenues, and finally in 1918, the Ahmedabad textile mill workers were organized. So all this, along with the happenings of First World War, the losses that have been incurred, the war losses, the loans that have been incurred, were all the foundation stones for the start of a non-cooperation movement. So non-cooperation movement basically started in two phases. The first phase was the Rowlatt Act. After the Rowlatt Act basically talked about checking the powers of the political persons and bringing them into trial for 2 years without any question, without trial, they could be detained. So that was the concept under the Rowlatt Act. But this was protested by numerous leaders. There were numerous demonstrations and rallies. This was confined mainly to the cities and the urban areas. And many of the leaders from Amritsar were halted, and Gandhiji was not allowed to enter into Delhi. Martial law was imposed and General Dyer took into command. When General Dyer came into command, you had the Jallianwala Bagh happening that took place. In Jallianwala Bagh, there were two kinds of people that were present there. One were those who were protesting against the government atrocity and the government rules that had come up. The second sort of people were those who were there to attend the Baisakhi fair. And finally, after the cruelty that was witnessed, Gandhiji believed that this movement should be called off because it is turning into violence and we would work around with non-violence. So that movement was called off. Then came the Khilafat issue. Now Khilafat issue, during the First World War, the Ottoman Empire, that was basically Turkey during that time, was defeated and the Khalifa did not have powers. There was harsh treaty that had to be signed by Khalifa at that time. So a support for the Khalifa, the emperor in the Ottoman kingdom, was starting in India, and that idea was led by Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali, who talked with Gandhiji, and Gandhiji supported this, and a non-cooperation movement with Khilafat was the basic idea that came in. So this Khilafat movement took a shape, and when this movement took a shape, there were demonstrations across India. Now many of the titles were surrendered. So during that time, Rabindranath Tagore was offered the title of knighthood. So he basically surrendered his title. Many of the people who were in the government jobs left their government jobs, and there was a call for Swaraj that started. So we were looking for a kind of independence or Swaraj. Many of the council elections were boycotted in most of the provinces except Madras, where there was Justice Party, which was the party of non-Brahmins. Foreign goods were boycotted, and we talked about wearing Indian goods or Indian clothes with khadi as a symbol. However, khadi was expensive during that time, but still people were trying to promote use of Indian goods. The foreign goods, the import nearly half between 1921, and the value dropped from 102 crores to 57 crores. So the foreign goods witnessed a severe blow in India. Now again, the countryside developments took place. Those are very, very important. One specific development was in Awadh. In Awadh, you had Baba Ramchandra. He became a sannyasi, and earlier he was an indentured labor in Fiji. When he returned, he had huge followers. He was against the talukdars, the landlords, the higher rents that were being offered, and the practice of begar, that was the forced labor without giving them payments. So all those issues were brought into focus by Baba Ramchandra, and he organized the Awadh Kisan Sabha along with Jawaharlal Nehru. There were also Nai Dhobi Bands that were organized across the country, and nearly 300 branches were set up around the region in the protest of these issues. Similarly, in Andhra Pradesh, in the Gundam Hills, you had the militant guerrilla movement that started in 1920s. That was again an anti-colonial government movement. It was led by Sitaram Raju. Now, Sitaram Raju was very popular among people. He was considered as a man who could make predictions, who could tell the future, who could heal people and survive even if the bullets are shot. So, he was respected. However, later on, he was executed. But he ultimately became a folk hero of that region. Similarly, you had the Inlands Immigration Act of 1859. Under that act, plantation workers were not allowed to leave the tea gardens or the plantations without the permission. In case they do so, they were caught and put into jails. So workers now felt that under Gandhi Raj, we can have our own lands and we can revolt. So people started to move out of the plantations. Gandhiji during this time raised the slogan Swatantra Bharat, and this was a kind of emotional appeal. This gained emotional appeal by a lot of common people during that time. After that, you had the Chori Chora incidents that took place, and Gandhiji again believed that these violent practices are not what we are doing for or what we are meant for, and non-cooperation movement was again called off. So it was withdrawn in February 1922. Now there were two groups. One was led by C.R. Das and Motilal Nehru, who formed the Swaraj Party and tried to argue in return of the council politics. However, the other group was under Subhashchandra Bose and Jawaharlal Nehru, who talked about radical mass agitations. Now, there were some important developments that took place post the non-cooperation movement. First of all, let's understand a basic difference between non-cooperation movement and civil disobedience. So, civil disobedience started after the non-cooperation movement. Non-cooperation movement started after the First World War. Under non-cooperation movement, people had a simple idea that we will not cooperate with the government policies and the government rules and regulations. Under civil disobedience, the idea was to break the colonial rules, to break the colonial laws that have been established. So both of them had a kind of different ideology in which they were executed. Now, what were the factors that led to civil disobedience? So after non-cooperation, there were three important things that happened. First was the Great Depression that was occurring across the world, a kind of global recession that was coming up, where the agriculture prices were decreasing and the peasants were finding a hard time to sell the harvest and pay for the revenue. On the other hand, in Britain, there was Tory government at that time, and that government constituted a commission under John Simon, which was known as the Simon Commission. When the Simon Commission came to India, it was greeted with a message, Simon go back or go back Simon. Now, this commission did not had any representation from India, and people were not willing to accept this. Again, Irwin was in India during that time, and Lord Irwin in 1929 believed a dominion status for India, or announced a dominion status for India, and called for a roundtable conference to discuss. The first roundtable conference was rejected by Congress during that time. However, the radicals were assertive, but liberals lost their influence during that time, and Jawaharlal Nehru in the Lahore session, the Lahore Congress, they talked about the concept of the demand for Purna Swaraj or complete independence for India. Now, under this, what was happening was Gandhiji initially was not in favor of this, but later on he believed that okay, we should sign the Gandhi-Irwin Pact, and Gandhiji attended the second roundtable conference. When he came up, when he came back, he was highly disappointed. The only thing that the government could do was to release the political prisoners at that time, but this pact was not successful. Now, initially, there were few foundation stones before the civil disobedience movement. The first was the Hindustan Socialist Republican Army that was founded with Bhagat Singh, Jatin Das and Ajay Ghosh. Then similarly, you had the Bhagat Singh and Batukeshwar Dutt who threw the bomb in the legislative assembly. And also there was an attempt to blow the train in which Lord Irwin was travelling. Finally, in 1930, there was a letter to Irwin that was given, and that letter had 11 demands. Of that, one demand was to abolish the salt taxes. Now, in India, so far, the colonial government was trying to have a monopoly over the salt production and was putting up taxes on the salt. Gandhiji and his followers, his 78 trusted followers who had the Dandi March or the Salt Satyagraha, who started that, believed that this salt is something that is available freely, and we would go to the coastline, we would create our own salt, and we would break the colonial rules that existed. So Salt Satyagraha was one of the first efforts that was done under the civil disobedience movement. Now, under Salt Satyagraha, the march was from Sabarmati to Dandi. It took nearly 24 days to complete. Now, as we said, there was refusal to pay taxes on salt. Government was not accepting it. There were huge protests across India. Abdul Ghaffar Khan, who was a disciple of Gandhiji, he was arrested in 1930 in Peshawar. Similarly, Gandhiji was arrested, and lots of industrial workers in Sholapur were attacked. Overall, around 1 lakh people were arrested during the Salt Satyagraha. Considering the Gandhi-Irwin Pact that was being proposed, Gandhiji called off the Salt Satyagraha. So similar to the civil disobedience, as we have seen, where after the Rowlatt Act, after the General Dyer and the Jallianwala Bagh happening, non-cooperation was called off for one time. Similarly here, civil disobedience movement was called off once after the Salt Satyagraha, and he participated in the Gandhi-Irwin Pact and the second roundtable conference. But in India, the scenario was different. Many of the leaders were in jail. The Congress was declared illegal, and there were many measures that were imposed on Congress during that time. On the other hand, you had the rich peasant community that was there, or the patidars in Gujarat and Jats in Uttar Pradesh, who were producing commercial crops, gaining cash income, but that was slowly and gradually disappearing, and it was impossible even for them to pay government the revenues that was demanded. So refusal of the government to reduce the revenue demands led to resentment among the people again. So people were revolting to decrease the rates. Again, what happened during the First World War was there was lots and lots of production that was required for the industrial use. As a result, the industrialists, the big merchants, prospered during the time of First World War. So at this time, they were demanding protection against the import of foreign goods, and also the rupee sterling foreign exchange ratio would discourage this import. So those were the two things that were being asked by the Indian merchants during that time. As a result, two organizations were formed, the Indian Industrial and Commercial Congress and finally FICCI in 1927, mainly led by Purushottam Das Thakur Das and G.D. Birla, and they tried to give financial assistance to the other small businesses, and they refused to buy and sell the imported goods in India. Now, there was strikes among the railway workers, the dock workers, the factory workers, the tin workers. They were wearing Gandhi caps and protesting. Large scale protest was commonly seen, and again there was kind of limits that was seen under the civil disobedience movement. Now, this limit was basically focusing on few of the issues. The first issue was the Congress was ignoring the ideas or the issues faced by the oppressed Dalits or the untouchables during that time. Gandhiji said that if you want to win, you have to bring them into mainstream. So he dignified the roles of Dalit during that time, and he himself cleaned the places. He persuaded the upper caste to change their mentality and give up the sin of untouchability, as that was popular during that time. Now, the Dalits at that time were demanding separate electorate under B.R. Ambedkar. However, Gandhiji was of the opinion that this separate electorate could slow down the progress of the nation. Therefore, he persuaded Ambedkar not to go for a separate electorate, but to have a kind of reserved seats in the provincial and the central legislative council, and they were to be voted in the general elections as well. So they gave the depressed class reserved seats only in the provincial and the central legislative council, and Ambedkar accepted this idea of Gandhiji. After the Khilafat movement, after the non-cooperation, there was a kind of divide between the Hindu-Muslim ideology, and it was considered that Congress is now a predominantly Hindu group with leading groups like Hindu Mahasabha. Muslims felt alienated during that time, and there was a kind of Hindu-Muslim divide that was gaining momentum, and the scenarios were worsening with more communal rights breaking in. Congress was trying to negotiate on this and bring in more unity. Jinnah, who was the leader of Muslim League, was willing to give up the demand for separate electorates only if Muslims are given reservation of the seats in Central Assembly and representation in proportion to the population in the Muslim-dominated provinces of Bengal and Punjab. So that was the key idea that they were focusing on. However, the Hindu Mahasabha leader Jaikar during that time opposed to compromise on this issue, and many of the people raised concern about it. But the idea of nationalism still gained momentum during that time. The key idea that was led by Gandhiji was that Britishers could establish themselves in India only because Indians were willing to cooperate with them. If Indians are not willing to cooperate with them, there is no reason that British can remain in India. So there was a spread of nationalism that came through by various means. There were three basic ideas that were laid. The first was the depiction of India into a figure, and that was as Bharat Mata. So the nation was symbolized. The first image was given by Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay, who later wrote Vande Mataram and the novel Anand Math. Abhindranath Tagore also painted Bharat Mata as calm, composed, divine and spiritual. The next was the Swadeshi movement. You had the tricolor that was released, and this tricolor during that time was red, green and yellow, representing 8 British provinces and a crescent moon along with Hindus and Muslims. However, Gandhiji designed a Swaraj flag, which was later red, green and white in color, and had a spinning wheel at the center, which represented the idea of self-help or production of khadi. The third important thing was reinterpretation of history. So Britishers believed that Indians were at the stake of British government. They were incapable of doing something, and they were of the primitive ideology. However, Indians talked about their glorious past, the victories that they have achieved, the developments that they have done in the field of science, maths and religion. So all this formed a common ground for generating the feeling of nationalism. To summarize the whole chapter, since this chapter is very, very important, I'll just have a brief timeline here. So you had the World War first that happened. After that, Gandhi's return from South Africa, that was an important event. You had the Rowlatt Act. This Rowlatt Act was called after the Jallianwala Bagh incidents. And after that, you had the Khilafat issue that was raised. Both these were the formations of non-cooperation movement in India. After the Khilafat movement, you had a kind of Chauri Chaura incidents, and Gandhiji called back the non-cooperation movement. So non-cooperation movement ended here. After that, post 1920s, there were two main happenings. It was the Great Depression, and the second important was the Simon Commission that came to India. In opposed to that, you had the Salt Satyagraha that was released by Gandhiji, And after Salt Satyagraha, you had the Gandhi-Irwin Pact that was signed. But this Gandhi-Irwin Pact and the second roundtable conference came out to be a failure. And finally, you had the civil disobedience movement that was continued. Now, across all these developments, we have seen how Indians had a rising idea of nationalism that was prominent during that time. The concept of Purna Swaraj was laid in 1929 in Lahore session, where we talked about the complete independence, which was later on achieved. So those were the key developments. Some of the important questions from this section would be definitely the difference between the non-cooperation and the civil disobedience movement. What were the making factors for the non-cooperation movement as well as the civil disobedience movement? Understanding or writing a short note on the Khilafat and the Rowlatt Act are very, very important. So those are some of the important questions that could be framed from this section. So stay tuned for our other lectures on history. We'll be coming up with more interesting lectures and some of the most important sections in history in the upcoming classes. So stay tuned. Have a very good day ahead.